My name is Natan Shaked, and I will be chairing this specific session, and I'm also co-chairing the conference. We have four lectures in this conference, two from engineering departments, one from chemistry, and one from physics. After this session, we will have dinner and then a social event starting at 8:30. In the evening, I will announce the details in between the lectures. Our first lecturer is Ady Arie. He is from the School of Electrical Engineering. He will talk about structured super oscillating beams of photons and electrons.
Okay. Thank you, Nati, and thank you for all the organizers for inviting me to the Dead Sea. It's always a pleasure to come to the Nano Center workshops. So I'm going to talk about super oscillating beams. This is already an experimental result of such a beam, where here we can have a spot which can be as small as we want. It can be much smaller than the wavelength. And moreover, this feature can propagate to the far field. And we can also structure it, and we can use it for various applications. I will show you one nice application of manipulating particles by trapping them here in this point. Okay, so what is super oscillation? This is a concept that has its roots in quantum mechanics. It started from the concept of weak measurement that was proposed by Yakir Aharonov and Lev Weidman. But then Sir Michael Berry further developed it, and the idea is the following, that we can have a band-limited function that can oscillate locally as fast as we want. So this is an illustration. This is a band-limited function. This is a very simple function. It's just a rect function. Obviously, it's band-limited because there's nothing here. And so we know that the Fourier transform of it is just a sinc function, and the oscillations here are inversely proportional to the width of this function. So this is not a super oscillating function, but in a minute I will show you functions that are band limited but can oscillate as fast as we want. Okay? So in order not to make it so much mathematical concept, let's look at this example that Michael Berry proposed. And the idea is that we can take the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven, and we can transmit it on a 1 hertz channel. So this is Beethoven, and he's not very happy from what's going to happen now. Why? So we'll start with the 1 hertz. We'll start with the 1 hertz signal. Then we will add a signal which has a lower frequency, okay? And we add another signal which has even lower frequency. And we continue this way, and I don't know if you can hear. Yes? Okay, yes, the podium is for Beethoven. Okay, thank you. So, how could it be? How could it be that we add all these low frequency signals, and we still get the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven. So I'm showing you only part of the picture, because there is also what happens here and what happens here. So in fact, this function is very long. It starts long before we started to hear the Ninth Symphony, and it continues way after it. And if we do the Fourier transform, it will be a 1 hertz. It will be limited by 1 hertz. But locally, it can oscillate very fast, okay? That's the idea of super oscillation. So, and this is not a very efficient way to, by the way, to transmit the symphonies of Beethoven. This is the 1 over this number is the efficiency of how it works. So it's not a very efficient process, but nevertheless, it can work. Okay, so I'm going to show a simpler example because I don't know how to do it with the Ninth Symphony, but I'll show you a very simple example of super oscillating function that we can also realize in the lab. So what is this function? This is the just a, here we have a cosine function. We shifted it by some fixed value, s, and then we take the square of it. Okay, that's my function. So let's look at it. This is shifted cosine. Okay, s can be between 0 and 1. So if it's 1, it just goes all the way down. And then I take the square, so I get this red function. Okay, and this red function, you can see that it can oscillate as fast as we want. And the oscillation is determined by s. Although this is it's quite clear that this is a band-limited function. It's just a cosine. So even we can open it, and you can see there is no frequency larger than f. Okay, nevertheless, the oscillations here are as fast as we want. Just for illustration, here I put the highest frequency. This is the highest frequency of this function, and you can it's this purple line. And you can see that these oscillations are faster. And of course, if we want very fast oscillation, there will be a penalty. S should be closer to 1, and therefore we'll have only a very small amplitude here. Okay? So also, let's see how it works in the Fourier representation. So what is a cosine minus some offset? Cosine is just, we can take, for example, these two delta function minus an offset. Okay, and but usually we don't like to work with delta functions in experiments, so we convolve it with some window, with some rect function, and then that's it. This is all we need. If we have something which is positive, then negative, then positive again, we do the Fourier transform, we'll get a super oscillating function. It's very simple. Okay? And then there are many applications. I will show you a few of them. There's a lot of interest in imaging, to use super oscillating for imaging. In fact, this has a very long history. Before Weidman and before Aronov and before Berry, there was Toraldo di Francia. And before Toraldo di Francia, there were people from the microwave community. And even before that was Lord Rayleigh. All of them played with all kinds of apertures that can give very small spots. So the idea here is the following. We have a lens, so the size here of the beam is the Fourier essentially given by the Fourier transform of this aperture. But if we have some super oscillating modulation in the aperture, we can get features which are much smaller than lambda f number, than the diffraction limit. Okay? I'll show you some examples, some experimental results of this. Now we can take all what we said and use it. So this is the function that I discussed before. So it's minus 1 at some, maybe I'll show it here. It's minus 1 on some ring, and it's plus 1 on an internal circle. I can also add some carrier frequency, but this will not change the result. And then I send this to a lens, and here I will get a super oscillating spot. So the feature here can be as small as I want. It can be much smaller than lambda f number. And moreover, because it's a band-limited function, there isn't any frequency which is larger than 1 over lambda. So this beam can propagate to the far field. There's no problem with it. It's not like an evanescent wave. Okay. Also, the size of this is the feature is determined by the radius in which I do this jump from plus 1 to minus 1. So this is the equivalent of the s, the shift of this cosine function that I showed before. Okay. So now let's look at some applications that were done in Tel Aviv University. So the first one is with in electron optics, and the idea is to do super-oscillating electron beams. So some of you may know that there actually was a revolution in the last 5 years in the field of electron optics. Up until that time, there were very limited tools to manipulate electron beams, but now this has changed thanks to mainly to nanofabrication capabilities. So we can design and fabricate masks that we manipulate arbitrarily the electron wave function. So this is how such a setup looks like. There is some source, there are some collimating lens, these are magnetic lens. Then I can put some mask, here is a phase mask, but I can also use an amplitude mask. And then I can generate any beam that I want, okay? And since we are in the workshop of the Nano Center, so I can say that these specific masks are made in the Nano Center, mainly thanks to focused ion beam milling. So the idea is that we can get very thin silicon nitride films. Thin can be anywhere between 30 nanometers to, let's say, 100 nanometers. And then we can mill them by focused ion beam. This could be either an amplitude mask or a phase mask. So how is it an amplitude mask? We can just cover everything with some metal, let's say with gold, which is opaque for the electrons. And then we can define some openings. So we essentially remove the metal in here or here, wherever you see a dark region. And then the electron passes. So this is a mask that generates electron Ady beams. This is a mask that generates electron vortex beams. And also we can do phase mask. In the phase mask, we just change the thickness of the silicon nitride. So a very small thickness of silicon nitride, around 40 nanometers, is sufficient to generate a phase shift of pi. So by just changing the thickness, we can generate any phase variation between 0 to 2 pi. So these are some examples. So instead of making a vortex beam with this way, this makes an off-axis vortex beam. This is something that makes on-axis vortex beam. It's a spiral phase plate. So the thickness varies in a spiral manner. So this will generate an electron vortex beam on-axis. Here, this is a different example where we take two quadrants and we remove about 40 nanometers. So we generate a phase difference of pi. With these two have the same phase, but it's pi different than these two quadrants. So if we pass through it, we will generate Hermite-Gauss one-man mode, and so on. And all these experiments are done inside an electron microscope. I showed you before an illustration, but this is the actual tool to do it. So the gun is somewhere here. Then we can put the masks here, and then we can look here. In fact, here there is a camera that makes the pictures. And the nice thing about the electron microscope is the wavelength is very small. It's only a few picometers. Okay, so this is just to show capabilities of shaping electron beams. These are masks, and these are some shapes that you can generate. So now let's go back to super oscillation. So I already showed you how to make super oscillation in general. Now we are going to implement them for electron optics. So this is the mask. Again, this is a circle with some value and a ring which is pi phase shift, with a pi phase shift. So this is an off-axis case. So there is some carrier frequency. And the pi phase shift means that here there is some black line and it continues to a white line. And then it's black line again. This is the pi phase shift. So once we do it, you will get a super oscillating beam in the first diffraction order. And just to show you that we can beat the diffraction limit, or at least we can have features that are smaller than the diffraction limit. So this is just our reference. This is just a regular aperture. And this is the size. This is calculation. This is measurement. Here it's 26 nanometers. And once we do these masks, we can get small. These are two examples with different radius where we do the jump. So we can get much smaller values. Here it's 13 nanometers. It's about a factor of two. Now, these measurements were done with very small numerical aperture in order to show the effect. But with electron, as I said, in electron microscope, we can get a much smaller size because the wavelength is very small. So this is a second experiment. Essentially, it's the same type of experiment, only with a larger numerical aperture. So again, this is the reference. This is just a regular mask. And this is a mask that generates a super oscillating beam. So if we use this mask, this is with 5 micron size, This is the size, this is the diffraction limit, it's around 600 picometer. Once we go to this super oscillating mask, we can get something which is roughly a factor of three less. It's about 220 picometer. And we can go to larger numerical aperture, and we can get even smaller than this. So here the diameter is about 200 picometer, or the radius is 100 picometer. So it's below the size of many of the atoms we are familiar with. And here this is already not limited. This is already limited by the ability to image this this shape to the camera, because now this is so small that we are already suffering from the aberrations of the optics that imaged it to the camera. But anyway, it shows that we can get to the angstrom or even sub-angstrom regime. I'll show you in a minute the limit. And also we can structure these hotspots. So it doesn't have to be just a simple Gaussian-like shape. For example, we can add this term, which is azimuthal phase, phase the azimuthal angle times some integer. So this makes it a vortex beam. So what happens is that this is a super oscillating beam, so this can be made as small as we want, but also it can carry orbital angular momentum. And then we can also look at what is the limit, what's the theoretical limit, how small it can be. So we can go to around 20 picometer. This is assuming limitations which are now in the state of the art microscopes, electron microscopes. I should say in the optical regime we can go much smaller than the wavelength. Here it's 10 times the wavelength. But still, there isn't any microscope in the world that can generate features which are 20 picometer size. The best is about 50 picometer. Okay, I think I can skip this. So now let's look at a different application, which is in light optics. And here the idea is to use structure the light beams to manipulate particles. So first of all, we already know this scheme that generates super oscillating beams. But now we will generalize it. And instead of just having plus one and minus one or pi and zero in the phase, we will add some modulation. I showed you one simple example, which is L phi, the making a vortex beam. But I can make it very general. I can make almost any phase distribution that I want. And what will happen is that this will structure the super oscillating spot. Okay, so this is a gallery of many different types of super oscillating beams that we generate. So let's start with this line. So this is the phase mask that I showed several times, where there is this pi step. This is simulation, this is experiment, this is the super oscillating feature, which is, here is around 160 nanometer. The wavelength, the laser wavelength is 532. And again, for comparison, this is a measurement of a diffraction limited spot under the same, with the same optics. So you see that this is much smaller than that. Then we can do vortex beams, but also, for example, we can get multi-lobe super oscillating beams. Here I show two beams, two lobes, but I'll show you later more lobes. Or we can make it an Airy-like super oscillating beam. So in this case, this is an Airy beam. This is a super oscillating Airy beam. So here there is a spot which is much smaller than the lobe of the regular Airy beam. It's about a factor of four smaller. Okay, this is 3D volumetric measurements of the same thing. So you can see that this is a super oscillating feature. If it's a vortex, it's essentially there is a hole, there's nothing in the middle. If it's multiple lobes, this is two lobes. These are the two structured super oscillating beams. And this is the way to measure it. Okay, so now let's do something with it. And what I want to do is particle manipulation. So the idea is that the following. This is what we had before. Now we will image it to here. And here we will put some, this will be a solution with some particles that we want to manipulate. Specifically, we will try to trap a particle here in the spot, in the central spot of this beam, and then we will image it to the CCD in order to see what we are doing. Okay, and this is already the results, but maybe we'll do it step by step. So first of all, what I can do is I can make a measurement in one case with a super oscillating beam, and in the other ones with a regular Gaussian beam. In fact, I can make many, many measurements, or I can take a movie and each time record the spot, where the location of the particle, and then I'll get some distribution. So this is the distribution with a Gaussian beam, and this is the distribution with a super oscillating beam. And you can see that the super oscillating beam can trap much better the particle. Okay, maybe this is more convincing. These are the actual videos. So you can see that this is moving. This is the normal beam. This is also moving with a super oscillating beam, but much less than that. Okay, this is why the distribution is much more narrow. And also we can, so first of all, we can derive some values from it. The important value that we can derive is the stiffness of the trap. So what we measure, we measure some distribution. It has some variance, which is sigma squared. And then this is the equipartition theorem, which says that K Boltzmann T is essentially the stiffness of the traps times the variance of the distribution that we measured. So what we see is that the stiffness for the super oscillating beam is much higher. Okay. And also we can try to understand why this is the case. So the nice thing with particle manipulation is something in which we can benefit from the local gradient of the super oscillating beam. The particle is trapped by the gradient force. So let's go step by step. This is a Gaussian beam. The dots are measurements and the lines is a simulation. And this is the central part of the super oscillating beam. Okay, so here this is the central lobe. Now, the gradient force is essentially the derivative of this line. So because here this is much, much smaller, the derivative in the case of super oscillating beam is higher. Okay, now we can take this gradient force and plug it into this equation, and we add thermal noise, and then we can calculate distribution in one case for super oscillating beam, in the other case for a Gaussian beam, and we can see this confirms what we also saw in the measurement, that we can trap much better with a super oscillating beam. Okay? Also, we can manipulate. So for example, if we do a vortex beam, a super oscillating vortex beam, now we can start rotating the particles. And if we have multiple lobes, then we can trap different particles. Now, remember that each one of these spots here can be as small as we want. So this is just an example of different types of, this is Hermite-Gauss-like super, Hermite-Gauss 2-2-like super oscillating beam. So it has, I don't remember, eight lobes. Now I can move to 2-1. I have less lobes, so I can trap less particles. This is 2-0, so I trap here only 3 particles. The other particles are those that are trapped in the ring. And you can see that they are trapped much less than those that are in the central part. Again, this is the same manifestation of the larger gradient force. Okay, so we can control the number of particles that we trap also using this method. And finally, also, this is something that also occurs with regular vortex beam, but it's nice also to see it with super oscillating vortex beams. So we can control the rate of rotation by changing the charge. Okay, I'm changing the charge, so each time, as it becomes smaller, rotations become faster and faster. But also I can now switch the direction, so it goes from clockwise to counterclockwise. Okay, and I'll just remind you, there is another ring here. I mean, this can be as small as I want. There is another ring, and in that ring I can have more particles, but they are less interesting. Okay, I don't know how much time I have. 2 minutes. So, just briefly, I want to say that the same concept can be extended beyond beams, and it can be used for shaping pulses, and it can be used for nonlinear optics. So for pulses, the idea is very simple. Essentially the same idea, yes, but the only thing is the following, that with pulses, there is a Fourier transform relation between the spectrum and the pulse width, the temporal width. So usually we say the best we can have is transform limited pulse. But what we can, maybe we can do something better. We can use the same, we can apply the same trick of this pi step, and then we can get pulses which have very narrow features. So just for, these are already measurements. So this is a spectrum of a pulse. This is the phase, and this is let's say, something which is very close to Fourier to transform limited pulse. But now we apply this pi step, and we can get here features which are shorter than the original pulse duration. And the same concept can also be brought to nonlinear optics. In nonlinear optics, the Fourier transform relations is between the physical size of the crystal and its response in spectrum or in temperature. So for example, let's say I have a crystal of length L. If you open the textbook, they say the conversion efficiency is sinc, is a sinc function, and the width of this sinc function is proportional to 1 over L. So if I want narrower response, then the only solution I had so far was to take larger and larger crystals. But of course, this is not scalable. So here I can have a different solution. I will just modulate the nonlinear coefficient with a super oscillating function. And then this I can have here something which is as narrow as I want. And this also works in experiment. I won't go over all the details, but this is measurements done in KTP. So what we have here, a simulation and experiment as a function of temperature, as a function of wavelength. So let's just pick one of them. Let's take this one, for example. So the blue curve is the regular crystal. It's a sinc function, but it doesn't look like a sinc because I'm showing it in a log scale. Okay, but these are the lobes of the sinc function. And now the green one is the super oscillating crystal. So here you see that the spectral bandwidth can be as narrow as I want. And the same concept can also be used for thermal bandwidth. Okay, summary. So I've shown several applications of super oscillations. One of them is in electron optics, where we can get spots which are much smaller than the diffraction limit. We can generate super oscillating electron vortex beams. I forgot to mention, electron vortex beams are interesting because they carry a magnetic moment. So this can be used to study magnetic materials with high resolution. In light beams, I've showed applications for particle manipulation. And what we've shown is that we can localize particles much better than with Gaussian beams. And we can also manipulate them. We can rotate, or we can control the numbers of trapped particles. And then I'll discuss briefly application in ultrafast optics and nonlinear optics. And before I finish, let me acknowledge there are many people that contributed to what I presented. So the experiment on particle manipulation was done in Yael Roichman's lab, and it involved Brijesh Kumar Singh, who was a postdoc, is now back in India. He's an assistant professor in Rajasthan. But also Yael Roichman and Arel Nagar. Then the experiments on electron optics were done by Yuval Tsur and Roy Remes, and some of them were also done in Jülich in Germany with Rafael Dunin-Borkowski, Pengan Lu, and Amir Tavabi. And the experiments in temporal optics were done together with Alon Baabad and Yaniv Eliezer. And this is a relatively recent picture of the group. So this is Brijesh. You can no longer see him in Tel Aviv, but you can see his picture. And who else? This is Roy Remes, and this is Roy Shilo, and this is Yuval Tsur. These are some names that appear upstairs. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, so this session is open for questions.
Yes. In the beginning, you discussed this problem of efficiency. So
yes.
There was this extremely large signal in the sides.
Yeah.
And then it disappeared completely. So
well, it did not disappear. I mean, we have it all the time. You can see it, for example, also you can see it in the results I showed, but for example, in the particle manipulation, I mentioned that there are also some other beads that are trapped in the surrounding. These are coming from these additional lobes, which can be much larger than the central super oscillating beam.
Any other questions? So practically, the side lobes means that, for example, if you want to excite fluorophores, it means that you won't only excite the fluorophore that you want to excite, you will excite fluorophores in the surrounding as well, right?
Yes.
So there is no solution?
Well, you can think of all kinds of tricks, you know. People have done very clever things in fluorescence microscopy. But if you just show what I, if you just use the beam that the simple beam that I use, then you will also excite the.
So then the question is that the optimal beam shaping that you can do in order to create these tiny dots of illumination?
Well, I think you can benefit when you are sensitive to some local feature of the beam. Like, for example, in particle manipulation, where we are sensitive to the gradient force. In microscopy, there were work by other groups, not my group, that have done some, you know, they essentially illuminate some object with this beam, and then they did some additional filtering in the far field. But I should say that these are questionable. These are controversial results.
Actually, I guess that I'm asking a more general question: is the super oscillating beam is the best method to create a sub diffraction spots? I mean, there might be another way to beam shape the rays, the beams, in order to create these tiny spots which are not super oscillating beams and do not have these surrounding areas.
Well, if you want a beam that will propagate to the far field, it has to be band limited. It cannot have frequencies which are larger than 1/λ. And you want it to be much smaller than λ/λ number. So by definition, it meets all the definitions of super oscillating. Then it's just a matter of how you realize it. But it means that you want very locally very fast oscillations, and still you want a function that is band limited. If you are willing to work in the near field, with an ANSOM, then you know you don't have to use super oscillation.
So I guess last question in this discussion: what about spatial filtering? Can you filter these side lobes?
The question is where you want to filter. As I said, there were some works where they filtered in the far field. But personally, I don't think this is this is a correct approach, because essentially you cannot at the far field you can no longer really separate between the spot and the ring. So if you want to filter, you need to do it in the near field.
Okay. So other questions? Yes.
So how fast do they expand compared to Rayleigh range? Do they expand faster than the Rayleigh range of without shaping?
So the question is how fast are they expanded in relation to the Rayleigh range?
So I showed some, even my first picture, they don't expand so fast, actually.
But you don't see the Rayleigh range in the picture.
Yeah, but, Rayleigh range is roughly lambda square divided by the aperture. So here, it's only a few microns with these beams. And you can see they don't extend. They don't diffract very well. And I think the reason is simply it's a band-limited function. I mean, you don't have, you can have, you are still limited with the frequencies that you are using.
Okay, so other questions? Okay, so if not, let's thank the speaker again. Moving forward to the next speaker.